Here we'll have a brief discussion about the biology of seeds. All higher plants, gymnosperms and angiosperms, produce seeds. The difference between angiosperms and gymnosperms is that angiosperm seeds are found inside fruit, whereas gymnosperm seeds are naked. Before the formation of a seed, two things must happen in both gymnosperms and angiosperms. First, pollination. Pollen must be carried from one plant to another. In gymnosperms, typically, that pollen is produced at a pollen cone, and it must be carried, typically by wind, to a female cone, where the eggs are housed. In angiosperms, pollen must go from one flower to another. The second event is fertilization. From the pollen comes sperm, which must fertilize the egg. Typically, there are two sperm. One fertilizes the egg, which then develops into an embryo, and the other sperm contributes to the formation of endosperm, food for the developing plant. After fertilization, the integument, or skin, around the developing seed hardens and becomes protective. Inside the seed, you will see several features. First, the cotyledons. These are referred to as seed leaves. They are storage structures that are also capable of doing photosynthesis. They're typically the first things you see above the soil. Monocots and dicots get their name from the number of seed leaves that appear. Listed here are some various features found inside the seed. You have the epicotyl and hypocotyl, which are essentially the developing stems, and the radicle, which develops into the root. Once the conditions are suitable, a seed may germinate. There are multiple types of germination. The two main types, epigeous and hypogeous, differ in whether or not the cotyledons are observed above the soil surface. With epigeous germination, the hypocotyl, which is the developing stem, is hook-shaped and pushes its way up through the soil. Once through the soil, the cotyledons are there to photosynthesize, but they quickly disintegrate when the first true leaves start to function. In hypogeous germination, the cotyledons never appear above the soil surface. Most seeds do not germinate right away. Typically, many of them required a period of dormancy. Often, this is the winter, when the conditions are not ideal for growth anyway. Lots of seeds require something to happen to them during that period of dormancy before they can germinate. For example, some seeds may need to freeze first. Whitebark pine is an example of a species whose seeds need to be frozen for a period of time before they can successfully germinate. The freezing deactivates an enzyme that halts germination. Some seeds need to pass through the belly of an animal. For example, some seeds may need to be digested by birds, where they will enter the gizzard, where rocks and sands will grind away at the integument or scarify the integument, thus making it easier for the plants to emerge from the hard seed coat. Even though fruit have seeds, those seeds are still often in development, and the seeds will not germinate until the developing embryo is ready and that the plant inside is fully developed and ready for emergence. There are a lot of conditions that are needed for germination. They are not the same for every plant. Some require lots of water, while some prefer to be dry. Some require lots of oxygen. Some may require light, and some require darkness. Some require existing on the soil surface, while other seeds require being buried below the surface. Temperature is usually an important factor that determines when a seed will germinate. Germinating when it is cold and freezing temperatures is rare. Now, all seeds don't last forever. In other words, a seed cannot exist in dormancy for long, long periods of time. Eventually, the seed will no longer be functional in terms of developing into a plant. Seeds can lose viability over time. If you were to go to the store and buy a package of seeds, there's usually a recommended time on when to plant. However, if you were to store those seeds for longer periods of time, perhaps a couple of years, it is likely that the viability will go down and the germination success will also go down. Some of our more invasive plants are successful because the seeds have a very extensive viability period. They can persist for a long time, which allows them to germinate when conditions are most suitable. A strategy that exists on some trees is vivipary. This is where the seed actually germinates on the mother plant. You can see this in this picture of red mangrove, which produces seeds that develop into floating propagules that are basically plant germinates. I mentioned earlier that the development of a seed depends on a fertilization happening first. When we hear fertilization, we typically think about what happens in humans. You have a sperm uniting with an egg, each having a single pair of chromosomes. The fusion of those two results in a plant that is diploid, or having a pair of chromosomes. This occurs in plants, but not often. Lots of times, the sperm or egg may actually have multiple sets of chromosomes. As a result, you may have what we refer to as a polyploid. With all angiosperms, double fertilization happens. With this, there are two sperm. One sperm which fertilizes the egg, and the other sperm which leads to the formation of endosperm, the food that will nurture the plant as it develops. Often, endosperm may have polyploidy. So rather than having a single set or a double set of chromosomes, they may have 5 times, 9 times, 15 times the number of chromosome sets than normal. Here is a demonstration about how polyploidy happens in lilies, a plant that is commonly known for its multiple sets of chromosomes. During the development of the egg, chromosomes replicate multiple times. Each chromosome set takes on its own job or function, but ultimately you end up with multiple chromosome sets, a plant polyploid. In plants, there are other scenarios that can occur when fertilization doesn't happen. With apomixis, sperm and egg, or gametes, never fuse together, but new growth occurs vegetatively. The plant can fractionate a part of itself off, and that part can develop into a new plant. With parthenocarpy, fruits can develop even though the egg isn't fertilized. This is what happens often when fruits are made that don't have mature seeds. Our seedless oranges and the bananas we regularly consume go through this process. No fertilization means no seed development, just the fruit. This concludes our discussion about the biology of seeds.